Good morning, everybody. Thank you for being here. It's nice to have you here, and it's nice to be co-presenting with Dr. Record. This presentation essentially deals with three components of three aspects. One is internationalization, globalization. I'll touch a bit on that and explain that to you. From there, we'll kind of segue into merging, showing you how internationalization and corruption kind of merge together. And from that point on, I think, and I'll touch a little bit on, after that, very quickly, on research or qualitative approaches to research. And from there, which many of us struggle with in this area, is on narrative writing or writing ethnographies. And Dr. Record and I are working on a paper in the book. We've collected all the data for this particular case and move on for there. So this is a non-fictional meta-narrative of weak leadership, poor planning, and bad management in higher education. And we were fortunate enough to get access to a particular case study. So this is a case. And globalization and internationalization are really, you need to think of them as two very distinctly different phenomena. Oftentimes nowadays you hear globalization is confused with internationalization. Globalization is a set of dynamics, and you could almost think of it in a sense as being a weather system that works its way around the earth. And internationalization is an institutional response to the dynamics of globalization. Many of us sociologists these days we talk about us being in a period of hyper competition. Storming phase hyper competition. And so what we're dealing with here is reform. So internationalization is essentially code word for reformation, institutional reforms. Unfortunately, corruption emerged as a theme of literature as in higher education. It was never really associated with the West, but it began to emerge in the early 2000s. You began to see articles of it in the literature. So the study of what is the relevance, why bother with this? Well, this really goes to comparative education and looking at what kinds of practices are happening in some places and what are happening in another. Is what is happening, the good things that are happening in one place, can they be borrowed, mirrored, transferred, can they be lent to another particular context? And that really applies as well to our case of study. So it's understanding the importance of this is if you can get a particular case and look at it and say, okay, can we extrapolate from this one particular case and apply to other cases in terms of the challenges that they face or bad practices that may transfer? What about vulnerabilities, especially with corruption? And so that's what this essentially is about. So it's really involves a cross-cultural investigation, making sense out of new or unknown, or comparing one's frame of reference. So multiple interpretation of issues, that always comes up. And so it's widening our conceptual lens and thinking as global citizens in a critical way. So it involves systematic critique and reflection. It must always accompany curiosity. Sorry, this slide's a bit it's a bit small, but I can very quickly summarize it for you. Really what I did here is I poured through the literature on internationalization and globalization. And this is a framework I came up when I did my PhD thesis. It had to do with concepts and authors, and basically I identified all the authors. Two concepts of phenomena being internationalization and globalization. I just briefly talked about those. I broke it down into ideology, cooperation and competition, where with internationalization, the focus used to be in the 80s, 90s, 70s on more on cooperation. That has now become fierce competition. Between universities trying to survive, and a lot of that's been affected with demographic change. And it also involves timing, process. If you are going to internationalize a university, you need to think about those, timing, process, function, purpose, that sort of thing. In terms of definitions, we've already kind of touched on that, but basically globalization deals with the market impact and dissemination of technology, information, values, ideas, internationalization, as I already mentioned, is an institutional response to globalization. So rationales that drive internationalization, this comes from Knight and Hans De Witt, all of them have contributed to this. Essentially, just from an institutional perspective, can be categorized into cultural, social, political, economic, academic. At the level of the, it can be at the level of the institution, on the national level, the institutional level. And basically, all of these factors come into play. And I'll revisit these very quickly. What I essentially did with some of my research was took corruption descriptors as identified by experts in the field substituted those in using Knight's framework, basically put all the descriptors in there for corruption, and I call them vulnerabilities. The only thing I would take note of at this, in this particular area, especially as it relates to corruption, is economics and institutional responses. Yeah. In terms of definitions of breaking down, managerialism is a big part of this whole corruption phenomena that's happening, and it's happening in all kinds of institutions all over the world, banks, you name it. These days, universities aren't special in that sense. And managerialism and corruption have kind of come about around the same time, or seem to have come about at the same time. Management systems have changed at universities. We call it hard managerialism, new managerialism. That all emerged in the early 2000s and dealt with an ideological movement, a crisis-driven shift away from perceived failed approaches such as total quality management systems. Involve centralized decision making, diminished academic autonomy, increased workload and surveillance, reduced transparency, fragmented work tasks, finance-driven descriptors, and detached senior management teams. And all of you who are working in universities can probably relate to these, no matter where you are in these days. Quality assurance. These are my ideas on quality assurance, but others share them. In a sense, when we talk about quality assurance, it shouldn't be just about surveillance. It needs to be about building capacity in terms of at the organizational level, but also building capability. So individuals coming into organizations need to have opportunities for growth, for professional development. And that goes to the human capacity theories, that's where that all comes from. Corruption is a multifaceted concept. It involves ethical, moral wrongdoing. Violation of trust for material gain by an individual or groups of individuals in positions of power. They abuse their power. They're often involved in power harassment, sexual harassment, you name it. And I think that's what we found in our case as well. Yes. And it's pervasive, it's dynamic, it's non-caustic. It weakens organizations, involves ethical fading, and has negative effects on the culture. Creates all kinds of problems in terms of organizational ailments, disorders. It's oftentimes connected to a broader culture that enables it, both within the institution or sometimes within the society. It's not necessarily self-destructive in the short term. It certainly has negative effects, as our case has shown, on the individuals that are working in those organizations. It ultimately leads to unwanted outcomes. So in terms of this had to do with an internationalization framework. Well, all I did here was these are characteristics of this international appreciative framework that I put together a while back. Involves knowledge dimensions, validation, recognition, domestic and international structural variation, and government and governance and policy. So these are all the things that need to be happening that are effective in their respective categories when we look at an institution that's is internationalizing or not, or somewhat. So those things we love. On to corruption here. This is a bit of a caricature, and I think it kind of applied to our particular case that here the guy says, the road to hell is paved with good intentions and good donations. I say intentions. And this has to do with the commercialization that's been going on at universities around the world and is also happening in our theater of operation, our theater of investigation. On to internal and external enablers of corruption. Again, this part of this Knights comes from Jay Knight's framework. And these are the enablers that make institutions vulnerable. These are the kind of outlying conditions that make it so that potentially a university is vulnerable or to those. And these are the sociocultural characteristics, political, economic. You can see demographics in here is a key one. Limited labor mobility, high unemployment, competition, strong competition for jobs, populist leadership, absence of political will, over into here, inadequate, incomplete information, weak or non-existent external quality assurance systems, or large quality assurance systems that are too external, and it's all about checking the boxes, but they don't really know what's going on inside the institution. And at the institutional level, insufficient remuneration or job security, inadequate policies, codes of professional conduct, or there's no real system in place to actually ensure that those conduct, professional codes of conduct are upheld. It's all on paper. And procedures aren't clear, accounting, monitoring systems, low management capacity, monopolies on decision making, and proliferation of discretionary power. So in terms of the more of these on the vulnerabilities here, but essentially that's all I really want to say about that. And we've done a lot of research on this. This now shifts on to our research, which is qualitative research. And I think we've been at this one for about 2 years collecting the data. So, you know, I worked as a policeman before, so investigations isn't something that's new to me. And there's a lot of information, more and more research out there on corruption in higher education. What is unique in our case is that we actually have a case. So we were actually able to infiltrate an organization and get people to talk to us, and that's what our case is about. It's a meta-narrative. It's a collection of stories. And so qualitative research involves studies using a collection of a variety of materials, case study, personal experience, introspective, life story, interview, observational history, interactional. So we've got all this stuff. We've got the goods. And so qualitative research is interdisciplinary. It's many of you know all this already. It crosses humanities, social sciences, physical sciences. And it's committed to the naturalistic perspective. So ethnography, narrative studies, research lines of inquiries, there are many types of ethnographies, all fall in under the category of qualitative research. It involves an inductive approach. So you can use grounded theory, for example, and that's what we're using to analyze some of our data. And involves field text, research text, working with interpretive documents. We've got documents, we've got all. Qualitative data collection techniques involve in-depth interviewing. Focus groups, we didn't do any focus groups in our research. Participant observations, ethnographic studies, and projective techniques. And in terms of analysis of qualitative data, it involves categorization, obviously, and we're quite adept at doing that. Utilizing data, recognizing relationships, and developing the categories that you're using to facilitate this and developing testing hypotheses to reach. So ethnomethodology, for example, it's a line of inquiry, but it's also a research method. So you need to distinguish between methodological approaches or lines of inquiry and actual research methods. How am I doing?
Well, we have 5 more minutes.
Okay. Down to the writing side of it.
Yeah, so one of the things I want to say real quickly in connection with what Dr. Fenton is saying is that when you think about all these things, there's a lot of abstract concepts, it seems very somewhat distant. But when you are actually involved in the study of a case study where all those things, basically that those descriptors for corruption took place, what comes home to you through the narrations that you hear is the human toll. So I mean, almost, and how easily people are seduced to follow the leader, no matter how right or wrong that might be.
Ethical thing.
And we ended, and at least 4 people were hospitalized for stress with documentation from the doctor. So it's a big human toll. I just want to say a few things about narration, because my recent experience in the last few years has been as a writing novels and poetry, but my field is literature, linguistics and literature. So I'm very much interested in the nature of narrative. And obviously, I'm sure you know, everyone knows what a narrative is, but I don't think people necessarily understand how fundamental narrative is to our basic thought processes. And on the one hand, we have scientific paradigms for qualitative research and quantitative research too, but those scientific paradigms serve one purpose, and the narrative is particularly powerful because that's how we learn from childhood through adulthood. And basically, narratives was once the primary way that culture was expressed through epic poetry of Homer, the so-called encyclopedic knowledge of narrative. So anyway, narrative knowledge is not only intrinsic in a number of fields, like obviously history, literature, mythology, and so forth, but also has become a major part of cognitive studies, memory studies, and psychology, and so forth. Let's go to the next one. So just a few words on the challenge. The challenge of writing narrative, of course, is, first of all, I want to make a distinction between fiction and nonfiction, but I think the best model for ethnographic narrative, good ethnographic narrative writing, is the nonfiction novel. So I don't know if you are aware of Truman Capote's In Cold Blood, but it was the first novel, nonfiction novel, a story that was based on fact but told, written like a novel. Of course, with this kind of ethnography, you can't really write it like a novel because you have to protect the identity of the observers. But the challenge is to select what is important and to also try to find a way to present the story so that it comes alive and is persuasive. And Dr. Fenton mentioned being a policeman and doing investigations. We all know how unreliable witnesses are, but when you have 5 or 6 witnesses telling the story independently and you find enormous convergence on the same themes, in our case, that really reflected those descriptors we saw earlier on corruption, you have a pretty convincing case, and it's a cautionary tale for how we should conduct particularly new university enterprises, and there needs to be before the institution, actually ideally before institutions open, various protective measures should be taken to ensure integrity and honesty.
In this case, we have eight informants. Eight informants in the faculty of how many were there total?
25 originally.
Yeah.
And you know, we, and already over 40% of the faculty that started 2 years ago have already left as a result of this kind of system that is in place. So, and basically, what's important is the order and the emphasis. What do you emphasize? And it sounds so obvious and silly a way to say a matter of words, but I have to tell my students in my literature classes all the time, look at the words. I mean, really look at the words. So writing narrative, the nuance is as important as the paraphrase of the meaning. So that's all I would say, but I think I'm out of time.
Okay, notes on analysis?
Oh, basically, there were, as I mentioned, there were four people who left, who were paid to got their salaries, but were exempted from coming to the school because of psychological stress due to the environment they were working in. One of them started, had this problem after only 2 months of the program starting, and then every 2 or 3 months, another person went to the hospital or went to a doctor. So the toll, the human toll of corruption and mismanagement cannot be overestimated. So, okay, we're done. Sorry.
Yeah, this concludes our presentation.
Thanks.
State.